set the stage, we have with us Dr. Gulshan Rai, Distinguished Fellow, Scotch Development Foundation and former National Cyber Security Coordinator with 30 years of experience in IT, including e-governance, cybersecurity, and cyber laws. He has led the team to set up a national watch and alert system in India and also helped draft national policies on cyber laws and cyber security. We are joined by Dr. Subi Chaturvedi, Distinguished Public Policy Professional and Chair, CAII Committee on Creator Experience Economy and Gaming. She has been at the front and the center of some of the most pressing developmental debates of the time, from the digital economy, entrepreneurship and startups, to diversity and sustainability. She earlier on had recommended, as part of the committee under MeeTee, that the private cloud be used by the state and the public sector undertakings. Mr. Rajarshi Purkayastha head pre-sales Tata Communications. In his present role, as the head of pre-sales India MECAA SARC, Tata Communications is responsible for gaining an in-depth understanding of customers and market forces to develop solutions that add value to customers' businesses and enable them to mitigate any challenges they face to capitalize on opportunities. And Mr. Sameer Kocher, Chairman Scotch Group, reforms historian and author of bestseller Modinomics. And with this, I invite Mr. Kocher to say his initial remarks.
Good morning and welcome to you all. I have five very brief points to make. The first point I want to make is that the process of legislation is as important as the legislation itself. We have the winter session of the parliament. There are two important pieces of legislation that are expected, but the difference between legislation making between the two of them could not be more stark. One is the Data Protection Act, and the second is the law, whatever it is going to be called, related to crypto. Now, if you look at the Data Protection Act, it has gone through several iterations. It's been several years. There has been Sri Krishna Committee report. There have been exhaustive consultations. And finally, in everybody's wisdom, whatever they have thought, and that will be kind of introduced as a legislation. The job of what to legislate is that of the government. However, the process and the fact that they have listened to as many points of view as possible is extremely important before they come and make some legislation. The reason for that is that people, when the time duration is short for discussion, then the agenda gets completely hijacked by people who can shout the loudest or spend the money the most or, you know, be visible the most. So somewhere I think the essence of democracy will be lost if the plurality of opinion, at the least in discussion, does not prevail. As I said, we are not the government, we are civil society. The role of legislation is that of the government, but equally important is the fact that they've heard all points of views. Farm laws is a case in point. However noble the intentions were, however great the outcomes were, and I have been very supportive of everything that the farm laws said, they had to be turned back because people did not accept them. Perhaps one of the reasons was there was inadequate education of the people, inadequate consultation with the people. We had seen a similar situation with the Aadhaar Act, where the commercial use of Aadhaar was overturned by the government. It was like throwing the baby out of the bathwater, with the bathwater. You know, if the process was not so speedy, it was not so bulldozed through, perhaps the outcomes would be better and the country would have been better off. You know, when people oppose a legislation or have a different point of view, it is not because they have an agenda or they have vested interest. They just don't want the poor of India or the digitally excluded and, you know, some of these people to fall through the cracks of whatever system that is coming out. And those checks and balances are extremely important. Being heard is extremely important. And I hope these are some of the lessons learned. Now, Modi ji, when he started 2014, has given a clarion call for Startup India. Startup India is doing exceedingly well. However, parts of it I find is being degenerated as what I call Upstart India. Now, these are the naughtiest boys in the class who would look at the environment or the, you know, open ease of business policy, etc., and find every possible hole that there is and use it to the hilt. So these 10% bad boys will make, you know, life difficult for the 90% of the others who are actually doing something meaningful. What these people do, they would pick up the worst practices from all over the world, give it an Indian packaging, and then try to bulldoze it in India through policy capture, through voice capture, through, you know, every possible thing. So regulation in some cases is becoming, you know, upstart India holding a gun to the government's head and saying, we've got so many addicts, you know, so why don't you, since everybody is smoking something funny, so why don't you legalize it? So is that the way the legislation is going to go? And is that the way the democracy is going to buckle? I don't know whether that's the right approach. There are voices. Pratap Bhanu Mehta has written, Sucheta Dalal has written, so many others are writing. These are voices in minority who are saying, look at what happens to some of the others. Again, as I said, the role of legislating is that of the government. No one is trying to usurp that load. They have to do what they have to do. But these voices should be heard. Civil society must be heard. There's a complete hijack. I don't know how many Section 8 companies which are big tech funded have opened in the past 2 years. I mean, you lift a stone and you find a Section 8 company, and you know, all these suited, booted Harvard wala sitting there with no. Section 8 is a charity. Section 8 is a not-for-profit. It's supposed to work for poverty alleviation. And if you look at all these companies, none of them would possibly qualify in any of those areas. So why are they Section 8? I don't know. Now, India has made tremendous strides in technology competitiveness because of the Startup India ecosystem. UPI ecosystem and India stack is one case in point where we have taken the lead, and India is today a digital payments leader. So is this upstart India going to chip away on that advantage? If we have UPI as a payment system, which is working and working so efficiently, it's the biggest distributed ledger that there is possibly in the world. Why can't there be a UPI stack? Why can't there be a UPI crypto stack? Why can't the advantages of all of that be completely indigenous and be used in India? Why do we need the Ethereums and, you know, the really bad stuff? Again, inadequate discussion has happened. Maybe I'm completely wrong, but no one has made the effort to make me understand. And I think my voice is important. You know, blockchain and crypto have a huge implication on financial inclusion. There is this famous use case, Rajni use case, that Sharad talks about, or Iceberg talks about, where, you know, 248 rupees credit is required by Rajni, a vegetable seller, for one day, and she can give, you know, a very good return on that investment. So how do you do extremely high volume, very low ticket size transactions on credit? Because credit is a felt need of people of India, of the poor of India, of the traders of India, of SMEs of India. And that is where I think crypto and, you know, blockchain have an incredible role to play. If the power is harnessed, we could possibly, you know, tap into crypto assets that are available globally and make them available as rupee credit to small ticket size. And there is technology available to enable that. Unfortunately, I don't think that is even a part of the discussion or a dialogue. And I surely hope that they would think about this, and this would have a role to play. And finally, the fifth point is the burden of compliance. So while you legislate, you know, not everybody is big tech, not everybody is the top 50 Sensex companies. There are a very large number of small guys, very, very large number, who can barely afford chartered accountants. They've never hired a lawyer in their life. So how do you take care of this burden of compliance for proprietary companies, for MSMEs, who barely have the capacity to run their own business? I mean, they just about started doing tally and, you know, maybe PowerPoint. And suddenly you say, now you have to do GDPR, you have to do data protection, you have to do this compliance, that compliance, you have to blockchain enable. So I think the challenges it kind of faces are enormous. So is there going to be one law for everybody? Or would there be exceptions? Would there be a transition time that would be given? So these are some of the challenges we really need to ponder. Because, you know, from 18th century, India has reached 22nd. And not everybody, you know, the tail is possibly still in the 20th somewhere. So we have to be very mindful of that. With that, I invite my friend, philosopher and guide, Dr. Gulshan Rai, who's of course very much more seasoned. He's looked at the government in the inside. He's drafted a lot of laws. He can maybe throw some light on what he thinks our emerging challenges are, Dr. Rai.
Just because
thank you.
Let me also
another
role that you have taken up, which is on the global board of International Red Cross.
Thank you, Sameer, Gurcharan, my colleagues on the panel, Mr. Purkashta, Subi, and one of the audience. He said Aklesh said he's an audience, so I saw him. Aklesh, and so many numerous audience who are listening to us at this time and listening to the attending the program being conducted by Scotch by two young people there. Good morning to all of you. Sameer, I will start from the last statement which you said. The tail is somewhere in 20th century, and that's what the statement you said it there. Friends, I remember the days when I started writing the Information Technology Act. We were writing the 8th plan document, and we projected the need for the national information infrastructure. That point of a time, it is somewhere 1999, that is the kind of environment time I'm talking about it. And we said that there should be a need, apart from the national information infrastructure, we need to have a kind of legal framework, which should talk about the validity of the document and the email. Emails were very prevalent at this point of a time there. And I was part of the ARN at that time. Now, I have seen those complications, those days, things were much, much lesser as we see that. The digital transformation, which has gone in the last 20 years, is a mind-boggling kind of environment which has come up. The technology surface, the misuse of the technology surface, the use of the technology surface has enhanced magnitude by magnitude of what? If you listen to the statement of Sameer very carefully, I think he went from the technology minus infinity to plus infinity. I don't know. I was figuring out what name he did not take it, the technology. He went in blockchain, he went in fintech, he went on a data production, he went on all kinds of things. Now this, and he's right also, because the canvas has completely enhanced, the surface has increased there. Now if you look at the digital transformation, the technologies have changed. No one is talking about the web today. Everyone is talking about the words like AI, and rightly so, because AI, big data, is all part of your day-to-day life. Whether you say Apple Watch or Fitbit or a phone, most of the time, there is not a single application today which is not having some application, little bit, or the other application of AI or these kind of technologies. The issue of cybersecurity or the data protection was not there. We were operating in a standalone system. By and large, phones were not there. Connectivity was very, very poor or not there. There's no need. But today we are in a different forum. We are talking about a 5G kind of environment. We are talking about the next generation communication there. So these kind of a technological evolution has given rise to issues which are of the nature of policy, which are of the nature of a legal, which are nature of the technology, and which are of the nature of protection, need for the protection assets there. That's what the many issues have come up. Those issues were not that point of a time. So these issues have their own, and they are so intermingled today that we are not talking about a single technology. We are talking about anything and everything. We talk about the convergence of technologies there. And that's where the issue comes up there. If we are understanding one technology, we can address the technology, whether it is a process or a law or R&D or any kind of a thing. But if you are talking about a convergence of technology, we need to understand how the technologies work, how the technology interact together, and what is the impact of the technologies on each factor of them, is a policy, legislation, the other technology and everything process there, we need to look at how the things happen there. And that's why exactly the problem is there. I like his statement. Now, Data Protection Act, you know how it came up there? There was an Aadhaar Act. There was a need for authentication authorization. Nobody can deny that the utility of the Aadhaar, that's a different issue. The Aadhaar was envisaged something else, and now it has led to something else there. I don't think it was envisaged as identity document or for identification. Today is a more identity identification than authentication there. That's where the, over a period of time, it has shifted there. Fine, that's fine. That's all because things get evolved. We don't know how the technology is going to be used at the time of evolving it, and how things has gone a different manner there. Fine. But then the Aadhaar collected the data of 1.2 billion people. That 1.2 billion people there, and all kind of a data has been connected there. There were loose kind of a terms in Aadhaar. I perfectly understand because the concept of privacy in those days were not known. He said tail, but not known what kind of a concept was there. Even the GDPR, which brought out for the first time, the EU country, European Union country, brought out the issue for the first time in 2018 or so. That time Aadhaar Act was a reality, 2016 there. So a lot of data was collected and it gave rise to the issues of the privacy. It gave rise to the issues of the technology and other aspects also there. That's a part of it. Now, but the government should not, and then the Aadhaar Act was challenged in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court recommended that there should be a comprehensive, good technologically evolving, a technologically progressive a Data Protection Act, because it was considered that the protection of a data in the digital world will only empower the nation. If you look at this, the Supreme Court judgment, that kind of a statement have been made. Now, of course, all of you know the history. Justice B.N. Krishna committee was there. I was also a member. It went on for almost 1.5 years, gave the report 2018, and the government has taken a bit. Well, some people may argue, as Samir was arguing it, many of the things. I don't know whether he was arguing or flagging the issues there. From the 2018, when the first bill was framed by the Justice Krishna Committee, from 2018 to 21, there is a lot of technological transformation also has happened there. And one of the main factors, which Samit said, is the crypto kind of a blockchain application. Blockchain application was those there. Even the Bitcoin things were there. I remember there was a Bitcoin was $600, and today what is the value of the Bitcoin? All of you know very well. It was there, but nobody imagined that kind of a technological explosion in those days, time in 2018. Many things had changed from 2018. But the bill remained the same. Data Protection Act remained the same. Rather, little more complication has been introduced. There was an intention of the government to have a separate non-personal data, as is prevalent in the worldwide. But they brought the non-personal data also in the data protection bill there. Now, they have tried to address the issues of technology. But I agree with Sami, there are many issues which has emerged. They are not finding an addressal or answer in the data protection. That's one aspect. That's one aspect of the thing. The corresponding address is the policy. As well as the technological kind of a thing to address those challenges which may arise because of the legal or because of the policy aspect there. Now, what do we look at it? This is a cycle which is going on, and it's a fact that, and we can't avoid it, that law formation will take some time as compared to evolving. Technology evolving also goes on. The Bitcoin, if you talk about it, is gone more than a decade. I think in my view, the best is that we need to evolve a progressive kind of legislation. We put the progressive legislation as early as possible, carefully, that we should be open to amend it, open to change it in a frequent manner, in a modular manner there. because we will never have a perfect kind of a data production act there. Now, if you look at the present data production act, now obviously the JPC has already submitted that. I mean, I understand, adopted the report. So I understand they have sorted time, extra time. Maybe some issues will be there. Now, this bill is a very, very complicated bill. Very, very, very complicated bill. In total, there are 98 sections are there. The name of the bill, which the media says, is slightly different than what was recommended or the original bill was introduced there. The role of a non-personal data has also been included. But today, the bill, the issue with the bill is that it was drafted by the experts looking at the technological kind of a directions there. Now, today it has been changed purely looking into the legal aspect. That is the problem is going to be there with the bill. There is a prevalent use of the kind of a compression, non-compression, and all kind of a techniques are being used. Consent is one of the angle there. I can withdraw my consent. I can portability, those concepts. Those concepts are very, very challenging. In my view, those concepts should have waited till the implementation of the bill. Then the second part should have come. Left to me, I would have done that. Having my experience in the IT Act, first version, second version, today we are not ready. That's one aspect on the legal. You may prepare the bill, you may prepare, pass the law, but how to enforce? That is a question. First challenge we are going to face in converting those legal section into the rule. There are more than 90% section which provide for the rulemaking process. What I'm hearing is that it's not confirmed and I don't want to be charged by the breach there, that the act will be implemented in phases there. That's what the provision I am hearing it is going to be there. That is going to introduce another kind of a complication. And that is where I say implementation is the really thing in the act, in the legislation, where the mess up comes up there. That's one aspect. Maybe I will come back after the other speaker comes out. Now again, come back to the crypto kind of a issues there. Now the crypto issue, what we are every day, the media on the TV channels are putting the news, whether we take assets or no currency, that kind of a leakage is coming up. The mistake in my view, if I had to do, I would have done it, they bring out a policy, a white paper. At this point of the time, though the government may say that they brought out the policy paper 2-3 years ago and the bill was formed. But today the situation has changed. I would have done the white paper considering the technology. Gone again in a modular way and then implement and extend it as the time goes on. I would have done the same thing there because technology is changing and whatever, in every change, every transformation, there's a disruption. The bill takes some time aspect there. The third aspect is the capacity development. Today, whether we agree or we don't agree, the capacity is a very, very poor kind of a thing. Resources in the country are very poor and need to be upgraded. Now, whether it becomes the question of a law or whether it becomes implementing the law or whether it becomes the issue of technology development. My friend Aklesh would know how the fintech application, or Samir said fintech, things are changing there. Now, the fintech itself is coming up, the microservices aspect are coming up, micro applications are coming up. This is going to raise another issue, both with respect to the security, as well as what we have been discussing, the law, as well as the processes aspect there. So I think the first point, which I would say that there's a high time that we must enhance our resources, we must enhance our capacity, kind of a absorption, kind of a handling the subject there. And once we are able to do the first two things which I talk about it, it will be easier to do that. The priority should be in the capacity development and then going in a modular way rather than putting the framework and saying that we will implement in a phases or over a period of time. That is going to create more confusion and is going to be little more, it will not only confusion, but it will disrupt the economy and the ecosystem there, and we will have a lot of problems there. Sameer, at this point I will say, but I will come back afterwards. Let other speaker also get a chance to say.
Thank you. Gurshan.
Can we now invite Mr. Rajeshri Purkashta?
Sure, sure. Thanks, Gurcharan. You know, very interesting perspective from both Sameer and Dr. Rai. I'll pick up a few things that both said, right? The first thing which Sameer said was specifically on, you know, how to implement, right? So Mr. Rai talked about the policies which are going to come in, what's the concern around the policy, and Sameer also talked about how to implement, right? Now, if we look at, if I take a step back, if you ask me personally, I would say that, Data Privacy Act is something which is important and necessary, because, you know, if that is not there, the way my data, my personal data will be taken by anybody and everybody can be misused in manners which is not good for me, right? And that's where the need for the Data Protection Act and how to implement becomes very, very important. Now, whether it's a large company or a small company, they will have some data, right? So, for example, you have my data, right? I'm not saying you're a small company, but you have my data, right? Now, when you have certain data of mine, whether it's my email address, my phone number, etc., etc., many things can be done around it, correct? So, if tomorrow's Act says that you have to also implement Data Protection Act, how would you do it? Can it be easier? And that's where, I very strongly believe that we have to actually also think about, this as a service, right? To make it easier for companies to kind of take the act and implement the act for them. If we only give the act and not have a clear methodology of implementing it, I'm sure, people would not be able to talk to Mr. Tuteja, for example, or to Subi for legal and regulatory advice of how to do it, right? So if tomorrow, you come to me or anybody else comes to me and says, hey, there's a Data Protection Act, is there a module that I can buy which can be either privacy operation as a service or security as a service? We are making it easier, right? So as an industry, therefore, I very strongly believe that we should look at what the policy says, implement it from a tech stack perspective, as Mr. Rai was saying, and then ensure that it is integrated. And very importantly, what Mr. Rai said is that technology for the sake of technology should not be used, right? We have to also look at how it is integrating with each other. What are the things that are coming together? How it is speaking or interacting with the existing ecosystem within the company and outside the company? And all the points are coming together, right? Now, if you look at the data protection or the privacy kind of an architecture, there are a few steps which is must, right? How the data sourcing is going to happen, how it is going to be accessed, and how the exchange is going to happen, how authentication of the data will be done, how extraction of the data will be done, how the data classification will be done in terms of what is crown jewel, what is PII, etc., right? And in that, there can be multiple processes. So for example, we can't only say that it will be India specific. The company may be also doing some processes or having some customers of Europe, right? Wherein GDPR as a law can also come in. So we just can't say that when we are talking about, say a POC as a service or security as a service or a privacy as a service, then it's going to only cater to one specific act. It should have an ecosystem or a flexibility and agility to then look at the process requirement for all the different things and do it in a manner where people, process, framework comes together in a tech stack, which then gives back the service to the company in a manner which not only meets the framework, framework of the act itself, but also helps the company to do things in a manner wherein they are not really bogged down by either the act or the technology stack itself, right? So for example, it shouldn't say that tomorrow if you need to launch into a new market or have a variant of the product or service that you want to offer to the customer, it's going to take you 6 months. You know, why not 6 hours, right? How can we all help in that direction is what as people coming together as an industry, I believe that's our work to do. And through these discussions, I'm sure we'll get there, right? And very soon, it's not going to take a lot of time. Back to you.
Well, thank you so much, Rajashree. It's time to invite Dr. Subi Chaturvedi, Distinguished Public Policy Professional and Chair, CAII Committee on Creator Experience, Economy and Gaming.
Thank you so much, Kosher. And I'm really looking forward to this conversation. And it's such a pleasure to be amongst people who are the moving blocks. Sameer, thank you for setting that context. It's nothing short of brilliant. In this little amount of time, you've actually hit the nail on the head. And it's always a joy and pleasure for me to listen to someone of Dr. Gulshan Rai's stature and eminence. And thank you, Rajashree, for putting the context of business and the private sector. I take a step back when I look at an issue of such prominence, such as data protection and privacy. For me, it's very important to unpack what are the issues at stake and look at it from a first principles thinking. The how of it is really, really important. There's something that Dr. Rai said that strikes a huge chord with me when we say, when is it that we've done enough? So none of us will try and attempt at a breach of parliamentary privileges, but as very conscientious citizens, both representing academia, the private sector, and also working with the government in some capacity as trusted advisors to the government, we as citizens of India should be able to exercise that right to positively engage. And that is where, you know, people like you, Gosharan, and Sameer's work comes in, where Scotch as a foundation has been trying to be the voice of reason in the room. And I believe that it is never enough. So wherever we're at, it's never too late to say that there could be three more dimensions that we look at. How we engage with the government, what is the purpose and purpose delimitation of the exercise that we're trying to take. And the most important thing is, how do you make sure that this stands the test of time, both in courts as well as does not kill what it's trying to solve for. So when we're looking at now, in July, we celebrated 6 years of Digital India, one of the most ambitious programs of the government, which has had many, many legs to it. And it is, I believe, the government of India's sovereign right to legislate on policy. It is an elected government. And they have the ability to decide and choose and determine what is right for the interests of its citizens, the interest of the nation per se, look at India's rightful place in the global value chain, and then also step back and see how do you create an ecosystem for orderly growth of the industry. And this is where some of my interventions will come in. So when we started out looking at how can India play a larger role in the internet economy, there's a very ambitious target that the Prime Minister set for us. He's saying, how can we create a $5 trillion roadmap for India? And a lot of it depends upon unlocking the narrative around digital economy, saying not only does India understand back-end IT processing. Not only has India created some of the most valuable companies in IT from the late 90s and early 2000s, but still, when we're looking at the most nimble startups of today who understand opportunity, and Niti Aayog, I believe, deserves enough and more kudos for looking at unlocking AI. They're looking at consultation papers around drone. They're looking at technologies of the future. So if we're looking at a legislation which we referred to the Sri Krishna committee, and Dr. Rai has also been a member, many of us have inputted into that committee. So for me, the context is, what are we solving for? Is the present legislation enough to address that? And there's a very interesting point that Dr. Rai raised again, which is the frame or the lens that you use for casting the legislation. So this is where the interventions come in, that to make the assumption that the industry does not understand some of its responsibilities. The industry is trying to evolve an ecosystem where you can address some of the challenges around how do you use data. And this is where I'd want to table the six principles of data privacy. You know, so when we look at lawfulness, fairness, and transparency, when we look at purpose limitation, when we look at data minimization, when we look at accuracy, when we look at storage limitation, when we look at integrity and confidentiality, different countries have gone on to set up different thresholds. And businesses today are very, very smart to say that if we violate these principles, we're not solving for the long term. So to go in with the assumption inherently that we will use the stick instead of the carrot, that's where I have the first bone of contention to pick. Second, the NIST principles that the US follows. Samir, speaking to your point, which is very, very important, cost of compliance and regulatory burdens. So if we're looking at creating an ecosystem that thrives on real value creation, SMEs, even micro enterprises, when we put out heavy-handed legislation that says there's a blanket one-size-fits-all solution, this is where you're only as strong as the weakest link in your chain. And when I was working with the US, some of the conversations we were leading, the DA's office said there are only two kinds of companies in the US till date. One who know that they've been compromised, and there are others who are yet to find out they've been compromised. But how do you make sure that you bring out these conversations in the open? It is not considered to be an act of shame that your security has been breached. This is where the realization comes in, that how do you create greater accountability and transparencies for the industry to say, yes, we will own it. Yes, we will invite. Google and Facebook and some of the others have set that tradition. They say that if you find a bug in our process and technology, we will reward you upwards of $1,000. This open culture, so clearly India still doesn't have class action suits, and you will not be suing a company when data breaches have happened. This is a real problem. So when we speak as either industry or academia, we're not trying to brush issues under the carpet. Fair use of data, what we do with our users' data and consent, these are real challenges that we need to solve for. Second, what is happening to the data that is being created? Yes, we need to address that. But in the process, what we also need to understand today is data by itself means nothing. Unless you torture that data, unless you investigate that data, unless you allow big tech to work with that data, unless you create an ecosystem where people are not afraid to maybe de-anonymize it, but still be able to access it. We don't want a kind of regulation that is a straitjacket around your neck and that says, hey, we will put the fear of God in you so that you're very scared of even attempting to work with some of those norms. So as far as consumer rights are concerned, we have to work from an advocacy and awareness lens. It is very, very important that, like, banking went through a process. Pulse Polio and public service campaigns are a great example where we've gone and we've talked about behavior change communication. It is equally incumbent to say when we're digitizing as a country, when we're demonetizing, when we're saying adopt digital technologies, make sure that we're able to fully unlock the benefits of the trio, Jandhan, Aadhaar and the mobile, we start upskilling our entire population. So PM's digital literacy program, which is a sunrise mission that all of us need to back. This is something that needs to be integrated all through schools, adult education, continuing education. What are your rights? What happens when you opt in? What happens? What kind of consent are you looking at? Every single company, whether it's an old company, whether it is an established company, is right now trying to wrap their heads around how do we not just solve for India, but how do we build businesses that can go global? And that's pretty much the ask which is facing us today. When you're doing that and when you start looking at protectionist regimes or when you start asking for questions like data localization, the issue then is there's also reciprocity. If you decide to build companies for global scale, there are, as Dr. Rai mentioned very, very clearly, different blocks and different moving parts of the puzzle. He talked about an amazing way of implementation, which is A, how do you approach this? What is it that you need to fix first? So my, in all humility, what I'd like to submit is it's a bit like putting the horse, putting the cart before the horse. And the worry that I have is when you look at it from a legal lens or when you look at it only from a compliance lens saying, mujhe chor pakadne. So pragati bahut zaruri hai, uske saath uski disha, drishti, drishtikon, wo teeno cheeze utni important hai. The speed of progress, the direction of progress, the perspective with which you want to take this forward, and then to understand that how do I come up with a regulation that sustains it. That is one of the biggest problems. So if I'm looking at malware, or if I'm looking at ransomware, if I'm looking at affixing accountability on what companies are consciously doing or unconsciously doing, the intent is not to go after everyone with a lens saying inherently everyone has bad intent. Even in, you know, regular legal ecosystem, mens rea is a really important concept. Were you aware? What was the intent and what were you trying to solve for? So my contention here is the opportunity that you want to look at is, you know, take the example of Estonia. Other than getting married, divorce and buying a house, this amazing country allows you to do everything else online. When we are saying that the use of blockchain for digitizing all our land records, there is an investment that's required, not just from the mindset of the government, of the people, but also what kind of data do we put online? We've seen in the past experiments that have taken place where when you privilege one stakeholder, so the entire internet governance piece, you can look at the private sector, you can look at academia, you can look at government, you look at intergovernmental organizations, you look at media and civil society. All of them go in to make the world that we know as the internet ecosystem today. So, and there are exceptions where we say one stakeholder will not be bound by these rules. But as you've seen in Snowden and the NSA revelations, as you've seen in mass surveillance, there is a lot of accountability that is required of each of us, because at the end of the day, any system is also human. There are individuals who make those calls. There are individuals who make those decisions. So what are we asking today as a someone who researches the internet, as someone who served on global boards, as someone who's been part of, let's say, the United Nations Multi-Stakeholder Advisory Group, as somebody who's looked at the evolution of the internet ecosystem, that we do not solve for only today. We do not solve for what is the immediate. The framework that we apply has to work with the industry. And not just, when I say industry, I don't mean just the few large big tech. We have to go deep down. We have to look at companies that come out of here that have gone global. And we also have to look at what kind of regulatory sandboxes. Somebody mentioned privacy by design. Now, for a lot of companies, that starts with, do I get an ISO 27001 certification? Am I there? Have I met with compliance standards? No, when you look at privacy by design, it starts with how do you maintain the register of the people who enter your office at the reception? How do you make sure logs are done? How do you make sure biometric attendance records are taken? How do you make sure that if you're a gaming startup, how do you keep your user data? What kind of data you're collecting? For a lot of startups who are starting young, these are questions where they've not even started thinking about them. They're looking at being the best product engineer in the world. They're looking at creating the best app in, you know, your location to tell great hyperlocal stories. So as you upskill technology, as you upskill and create an entire nation of entrepreneurs, your legislation or the legal provisions will have to keep up. So how do you make sure that that flexibility and that nimbleness, because if this goes to the parliament in the current shape and form, and we're already well on our way, how do you then start looking at a situation where tomorrow you're not before the courts? Tomorrow you're not looking at then carving out FAQs and exceptions. And we've been there. All of us know who are present in the room. These are people who are virtually the architects of how our entire cybersecurity framework is standing. Dr. Rai, someone who's, you know, not just a professional I admire, he's like a father figure to me. He's an institution in himself, and he's a guru who's taught us all. And he's someone who's been so open and so receptive. And that's the kind of policymakers, those are the kind of champions that we're looking for, even in the government today, where this communication channel remains open, where there is a very strong fundamental understanding that any data, irrespective of any stakeholder which is created or collected, A, does not end up becoming a honeypot. We've learned that in the cases of large programs. And it also is due, it is also proportional. And if we're looking at a punitive legislation, so the act, even in Indian jurisprudence, is never to do retribution. It is for reform. And those are some of the basic guiding principles that we have to create, you know, even for something like this. So have we had enough inputs? Have we collected enough dots? When is it that we're ready? Or when is it that it's the right time? What kind of definitions do we look for? So these are some of the examples that we've learned even from the IT Act, that, you know, if you're looking at, let's say, an act that existed elsewhere, or if you took up some provisions, the infamous Section 66A, that was to look at mitigating and curbing spam. But as we've learned even today, that, you know, the number of cases have not ceased. And despite multiple notifications from the honorable offices of the Ministry of Electronics and IT, where they have personally issued out letters to every single principal IT secretary of state, that arrests are still being made under a section that has been struck down by the Honorable Supreme Court. So yes, we're a very large country. We're many Indias in one. There is an India and there is a Bharat. So when we start looking at an act of this magnanimous impact and proportion, my humble submission is, have we discussed it enough? Have we taken enough dots? Have we consulted enough experts? And do we want to create something which binds us in a loop where then we are running for how do we now retrieve something out of here? But the most important principle being, are we actually helping India unlock this immense opportunity? And when I say that, I don't mean that turn India into a collection market for data, or as manufacturing would say, make this a source for raw material or raw input. We're not just numbers, right? It's not about DAUs. It is not about monthly active users or daily active users. A lot of companies have made the mistake of doing that. My submission is on the contrary. Do we empower Government of India to collect and actually use data for prediction of or prevention of a COVID-like epidemic? So, for example, and this is my last submission before I stop and yield the mic in my time. When you look at doctors in India, the way they collect patient history is very, very unique. When people come to visit a doctor, for them, a lot of times it's not about only getting their treatment cured or diagnosed. It is social experience. They like to share. They like to talk. For a lot of women, it's the first time that they're probably allowed to go out in months. So the patient history, which is even collected, is extremely expansive. It is full of anecdotes, and the way doctors are trained in India is very different from anywhere else in the world. So India needs unique problems. It needs, with the use of technology, it also needs to have a construct around social and cultural mindsets. And to be able to exploit that, you have to have a policy that does not just take the best from GDPR or the best from what any other country may have created. So is it nuanced enough? Is it still so good that it's broadly, generally applicable? That is the question that I want to leave us with. And what kind of solutions? It has to be a bottom-up movement where you don't go top-down, where you don't say that this is what the law of the land is, and then you figure out a way whether it's sustainable, whether it is in keeping with the times, whether it is relevant. And that's my question. In experiments and in research, you can come up with a hypothesis and you can come up with a beautiful finding. But two questions: is it valid and is it relevant? Is it addressing the very problem that we're trying to solve for? I'll stop here.
Thank you so much, Subi. I am so impressed with the choice of chair for CII Committee on Creator Experience. Can me, every time I listen to you speak, you know, you kind of bring together everything so well. You know, one question that we've not looked at, I would like to ask that question both first to Dr. Rai and then to Raj. You know, we've increasingly becoming focused on this techno-legal kind of, you know, legislations. But how to legislate for a moving target? I mean, you know, if you say that we are going to legislate for blockchain or we're going to, you know, legislate a particular technology, with the technology itself is transient, you know. So can you say that blockchain is an asset and it's safe and it's a trusted thing without keeping in mind the developments in quantum computing? So should we be legislating for technologies or should we be legislating for use cases and misuse cases? So that's the question first. And how does the rest of the world do that? Because also, like Subi pointed out, Dr. Rai, privacy is a fairly alien concept in India. We have a need to be heard and told because, you know, we've had such faceless existences that we like to tell people, this is where I am, this is my two sons, this is what they do, this is what their wives do. And so why are you, you know, bringing about or, you know, inflicting a societal change through legislation, which is going to, you know, do some kind of an anthropological surgery on India? You know, how do you handle that? So Dr. Rai first.
Thank you, Sumit. First of all, I would like to express my great gratitude to Subi. As you said it, she is a marvelous person, very prolific thought she has and speaks very well. Thanks, Subi. Very kind of you and very kind of you for giving me so much respect on the public forum as well as in person also. Now, I think all of you have raised a very, very valid point there. And I was trying to continue what Subi has left it there. If you look at the, particularly, I mean, if I focus myself on, Samir, I have a 5-7 minutes.
Yeah, you have.
See, if you look particularly focus on the current generation of the framework which are going to come up, whether it's a technical or legal or aspect any process there. The role of technology will be very, very high. Now, if it will be very high, and as I said, today we are not dealing with one process, one technology. We are dealing with the convergence of technology, convergence of process. They're all converged together. Now, let me deal specifically with the Data Protection Act. We need this. We need the Privacy Act because the data is explosion is there. Data is flowing. God knows where the data is going. The issue comes up. And I am just, expressing what Subi has said in a slightly different, more sense there. The four concepts are basic underlying concept in the Data Protection Act. One is the consent. Other is your, the anonymization there. Third concept is sharing the data with the government there. And the fourth concept is cross-border flow of a data or the data localization. I'm putting them together. Now, when we talk about the consent, if you look at the consent in a normal course of a privacy, if you look at Data Protection Act, it requires data portability. It requires the non-personal data to be transferred to the government. It requires entire data to be anonymized there. And if you look at this clause 35, as long as it doesn't become a law, it will be clause, then it will become a section there. Clause 35, where the data is to be, all the security agencies are to get the data there. If I anonymize the data, it is my algorithm. If any service provider holds my data, he will anonymize the data. And tomorrow, if you ask him, and then I have a consent, the right is there to withdraw the consent. Now, whether the consent to withdraw applicable to personal data or non-personal data, whether I have a right or not right. Right of portability, data is anonymized, is my proprietary algorithm. I share the data with you, it will be taken as a breach. If I give the algorithm to you, it's a copyright infringement. So all issues, and if you look at the crypto kind of things there, the blocks are distributed not only in the country, but worldwide. Because you have to deal with assets. The government has not said, media has not said the government is trying to put the trading of the assets or the crypto kind of a regulation only for India, or it will, transactions will be allowed outside of there. No one has said it. Peer-to-peer transactions, again, is something which is depend upon technology. Now, how do you maintain the consent when the blocks are distributed? The blocks are not known who's having a block. That is hidden. That is a hidden aspect of the technology. This, how do you understand, how do you analyze the breach of a data in such a hidden concept? When the algorithms are mined, government has no control algorithm. No one has an algorithm there. And the third most concept is that whether we have the resources, manpower to understand these aspects there. So I absolutely appreciate what Golden Word Subi has said, it that we need to first be ready. To me, it appears, I'm very clear in my mind, we need the law, but we are not prepared to implement the law at this point of a time because a lot of training is required, a lot of other things are required to implement the framework there. And that is where the challenge will come before the government. And I think we need to prepare, we need to lay down, and Subi has mentioned very categorically, I appreciate her, that let us focus on setting the system there. Left to me, having experience in the past, I wouldn't have brought the technological aspect in the framework. World like a anonymization, right of portability, so it has never been implemented, though GDPR was done in 2018, it has never been implemented there. We should not be forcing companies to do that. They will do in any way. Every data in the transit or the rest will be encrypted there, anonymized there. But I fear that when the law comes out, it will impact many of the legislation in the country. And again, it will get challenged, and the authority which they will set up, it will take a lot of time to gear up technology, because these are all the provisions which are being made are technology-driven provisions are there. It's going to open a lot of challenges, and the right time and the message which Subi has said, that we need to prepare before we implement the law or we think of implementing the law. And I also agree with you that we must look at the framework in setting a system, not try to regulate the technology, because technology cannot be regulated. No way to regulate the technology. How do I regulate the anonymization? How do I regulate the kind of algorithms? It is impossible to do that there. So we must look at the processes, we will look at the system, and look at the other resources. Avoid all technological aspects, because nobody has a control on the technology. Thank you, Sameer.
Pleasure. So, Raj, do you have somewhat of a better understanding? Because for me, it is like legislation for a knife. You know, you can either chop onions or kill a person. So, are you going to legislate for the knife or the chopping or the killing?
Yeah. So,
do you have a better sense?
Yeah. So, Sameer, you know, it's a very deep question, right? And if I look at it from our own perspective, if you think about technology, right? Let's look at technology first. If you think a decade back, technology was used like a tool, right? However, specifically with the pandemic setting in and the way our lives are, right? Look at the screen time that we have at this point of time. Actually, technology has become the world we live in at this point of time. And this is going to be actually more and more true going forward, right? What will happen with technology is that you will be affected with technology, meaning that, you know, think about, you know, what's going to happen from an augmentation perspective, you know, augmented human beings, where, you know, we are talking about exoskeleton today. Tomorrow, exoskeletons will become more and more relevant, right? Personalized medicines is coming in, where you're talking about gene therapies and stuff like that. And all these things is connected to what you asked, right? The question that you asked is, you know, should we actually look at technology and think about it, or should we look at, you know, fundamentals and think about it, what Dr. Rai also talked about. You know, if you then think about the technology which is going to do this, right? So, for example, you talked about quantum. Actually, the next phase is coming in, which is known as neuromorphic, right? Where, you know, if you've seen the video of a specific chimpanzee named Pager, with Neuralink, the chimpanzee is actually playing video games for a smoothie, right? We are talking about molecular computing, which is wetware. Now, if somebody says, I'm going to look at blockchain and do legislations around that, this is going to fail miserably, okay? Next thing which you think about is metaverse, right? Now, you know, metaverse came as more of a, you know, game per se, like Second Life. You know, maybe many of you who are listening in have played that game. But if you look at metaverse of today, it's actually the next internet, where you can have your own avatar and you can live in that, you know, metaverse, where you can also work there, right? And you can earn money there. And that's where blockchain will be only a part of the entire metaverse. You know, blockchain is not going to be the metaverse, right? Metaverse is the universe of that digital avatar where you work, where you play, you know, you have contracts and so on and so forth. So the point that you said, right, in terms of should we look at technology and then do legislations around it? Absolutely not. Because as metaverse comes in, as you talk about neuromorphic, as you talk about wetware, as you talk about all the other new things which is coming in, you know, things like, you know, how the chip industry is going to grow, right? Where the information is going to be stored. You know, today, if you look at it, the storage is separate, the compute is separate. Tomorrow, everything is going to be integrated, which actually, from a tech perspective, you know, has a different meaning per se, because, you know, today you can say, okay, my storage is separate out here, my computer is out here. Tomorrow, that's not going to be the case with, say, Borofinos or 2E10 coming in. So what's going to change? So you can't keep saying new things as technology comes in. It's the legislation should be on fundamentals. It should not be on technology. That will be a mistake, as for me, Sameer. And I believe Dr. Rai also said the same thing.
Thank you so much. The bells are ringing in the next lot of discussions have joined in, but I think one big elephant in the room that has not been addressed at all, which is actually coming out fairly obvious from this thing. You need to regulate lobbying, because, you know, what you're seeing is happening is a manifestation of the big tech and, you know, the upstarts and the venture capital funding. Lot of money going into lobbying and hijacking Indian democratic processes. So unless and until, so first principle then should be, before you regulate crypto or gaming or anything, you know, regulate lobbying. Because you have zero legislative capacity. Your MPs, you know, come with the background that they come with, and expecting them to have an opinion on cryptocurrency and having a opinion on data protection is a bit much to ask. And then the agenda gets highlighted by whoever manages to reach them and get on the right side. And you know how people get on the right side in India. So that is, lobbying is what is giving a backdoor entry to killing of Indian democracy. So before we come out with any other legislations, I think we should come out with the legislation regulating lobbying. Obviously, it cannot be banned. It will have immediate set of problems, much more complex than crypto and gaming. But it's something that we need to look at. And I think as Scotch Foundation, we should highlight that lobbying must be regulated. I mean, you know, you have associations saying that they're writing the law for RBI. They have given that law in confidence to RBI. And RBI, as much as doesn't even murmur that in what capacity have they taken it or have they received it or not. So it's a tragedy that unfolds every day in front of us.